Good evening. I want to thank once again all of the people that work in the booth. They have one of those jobs where no one ever thinks about what they're doing until they make a mistake. Well, this was my mistake. I think the church office email will get a copy of the song service tomorrow morning, too. Sent it to the wrong place. But that is fine. It's good to see you tonight. It's interesting to be leading singing in the evening again. It's been so long. Kind of glad to. If you would, please stand as we sing these first three songs.
Trials dark on every hand, many cannot understand all the ways that God reveals to that blessed promised land. Love will guide us with His eye, and will follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by.
With the wings of, He is our.
Please be seated. Next, we'll sing number 44, Anywhere is Home. And after this song, we'll be led in our opening prayer.
Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to you, God, that you are our God and that you choose to make a covenant with us and to have a relationship with us, and that each day we can seek after you and follow you and to know you, God, and we praise you for that. We thank you, Father, for the many blessings of this life, for the people who are here tonight, and pray that you would bless each one of them in their walk with you. And Lord, we pray for many people, God, who are hurting, many people who have COVID and other diseases and problems, people who have cancer and sicknesses, and we ask for your blessing for them. And we pray, Father, that that you would allow their health to return to them, and Lord, that they can look to you in this time, and that they can draw closer to you as they go through these difficulties, and that you would bless them, Father. And we're grateful to you for the church, and that we can be a part of your people, and we're grateful for you, for your word, and that it guides us each day as a light, and pray that we would follow it closely. And Father, we're especially grateful for your Son, and we know that he sacrificed everything so that we can know you, and we pray that we would follow in that path, and we're so grateful for what he did on the cross, and that you raised him from the dead, and it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Before the lesson, we'll sing the first two stanzas of Follow Me.
If you'd like to follow along the scripture reading before this evening's lesson, it will be taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and I'll be reading verses 6 through 12. Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents, nor grumble as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the ages has come. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed, lest he fall.
I was communicating with my wife this afternoon. She and Daniel are still in Mississippi visiting our other son, Amos. And, of course, she knows what the topic of the sermon is tonight. And she was, I'm not going to say complaining about the title of the sermon. It wasn't that. But she said that she might be responding from afar tonight as they watch online, and I told her that I may be the first preacher in the history of preaching to respond to his own sermon after tonight. Akitoshi Okamoto is a citizen of the nation of Japan. He was arrested in December of 2019. The charge was fraudulent obstruction of business. The reason he was arrested was because he had made 24,000 complaint calls to his local phone company for reasons that included not being able to pick up radio signals on his phone. Yes. Now, that's an average of 33 calls per day for 2 years. Now, I have a lot of questions about that. One of them is, why did it take 24,000 calls before something was done about that? But that's neither here nor there. When I read that story, after I got through all of those other questions, it made me think and wonder, how many complaints do I make in a day's time? And if grumbling has become second nature, and I simply excuse it, what does that say about my character? We are in a series of lessons on these Wednesday night, in these Wednesday night assemblies, that we're calling No More Excuses, in which we're looking at different sins, different actions that the Bible calls sin, that we tend to have, if I can be redundant, a tendency to overlook. Sins that we find it easy to dismiss in ourselves, to excuse in ourselves. And we're looking at them from the standpoint of the fact that they are sin, and therefore, we should not excuse them. We should try to do something about them, to grow, to improve, to continue to mold our character to where it becomes more and more like the character of our Savior. And so tonight we're going to tackle the pastime of a lot of us, complaining. Robert read for us from 1 Corinthians chapter 10 a moment ago. And it's a great text, and we'll refer to it a little bit later in our lesson. But I want us to begin in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Paul's letter to the church at Philippi has some of the most beautiful and some of the most challenging texts in all of the New Testament. It was written to a church that was very special to the Apostle Paul. One of my instructors years ago, Brother Avon Malone, referred to Philippi as Paul's sweetheart church, one that he was very close to. And he would say things like, "I thank my God in every remembrance that I have of you." Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. But it was also a church that was imperfect. They had, among other things, some rumblings of disunity. Paul comes back to that topic several times in the letter. He said in chapter 1, verses 27 and following, that he said, "Whether I come and see you or not, I want to hear that you are standing fast in one faith, striving together for the faith of the gospel, standing fast in one spirit, striving for the faith of the gospel." And he mentions even later in the letter, in chapter 4, verse 2, he calls a couple of ladies by name and encourages them to be of the same mind. And so there were these rumblings of disunity that Paul addresses. And one of the ways that he does that in chapter 2 is by addressing the subject of humility. And he looks at three examples of humility in chapter 2. The obvious one and the most important one is the example of Jesus, verses 5 through 11. "Have this mind in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." But he also looks at the examples of Epaphroditus and Timothy as examples of the self-emptying spirit, the self-emptying mind, the willingness to put others ahead of oneself. And that's the admonition in the first few verses of that chapter, to think more of others than one does of himself. And it's in the midst of that discussion that we find verses 14 through 16 that I call your attention to now. "Do all things without grumbling or disputing, so that you will prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent, children of God above reproach, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you appear as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I will have reason to glory, because I did not run in vain, nor toil in vain." Do all things without grumbling or disputing, without murmuring or complaining. Well, the command is clear enough, but let's unpack some of the details. And so we're going to cover the subject tonight by asking two questions and hopefully answering them from the Word of God. First of all, and we did this last week, what are we talking about when we're talking about grumbling or complaining? What exactly is that? What does it include and what does it not include? And then, in the second place, why is it so bad? Why has God told us not to do it? Well, we'll look at a couple of reasons for that. All right, so what are we talking about? When we say that we're to do everything without grumbling, without complaining, what exactly does that mean? Does that prohibition mean, for example, that we can never voice a negative comment about anything? Does it mean, for example, that if it's raining outside and I prefer sunny weather, is it wrong? Is it sinful for me to say, "Wow, I can't wait for the sun to come out again. It sure has been raining a lot lately. I'm anxious to see the sun." Is it sinful if I'm in pain, in physical pain, for me to say, "Wow, I wish this headache would go away. I'm tired of the headache that I've had all day"? Is it sinful to do that? What if I'm suffering from an illness or a disease? Is it sinful for me to make any kind of negative comment or statement about that condition? "I'm tired of feeling bad. I sure would like to feel better. Are those sinful statements? I believe the answer to that is no, they're not. And let me explain why I think that's the case. The term grumbler, the term that's translated by the English word grumbling or complaining in Philippians 2, is given the following definitions. Here are a smattering from some of the Greek lexicons that I have access to. Literally, the word means a statement of discontent uttered in a low voice. That's why it's sometimes called murmuring, sometimes translated murmuring. It's discontented language that's kind of muttered under one's breath. Now, I can't help but think of this because it takes me back to my childhood and some of the muttering noises of Yosemite Sam. Now, sometimes he said those extremely loudly, but at other times he just kind of mumbled under his breath as he was walking away from something Bugs Bunny had done to him. We get that idea of mumbling under the breath. That's literally what this word means. Now, the extended definition includes this. Again, from one of the Greek lexicons that I have. The expression of secret and sullen discontent. Another reads this way. To grumble because of disappointed hopes. So, as I read through many of these definitions and looked at how the word was employed and different, all of the research that's gone into the word and how it was used and all of that, I came away with this understanding that the word has a deeper meaning than just a casual expression of a minor annoyance, like, for example, the weather. If it's 105 in the shade in July, it's not a sin necessarily to simply say, wow, it's hot. I wish it would cool off. I can't wait for the fall. This word doesn't have to do with expressions like that of a minor annoyance or a desire for a different circumstance, like relief from pain. The word speaks really of the grumbling that bubbles forth from a heart that believes really that it's been wronged, that it's been deprived of something that it deserves, that a legitimate claim has not been met, that somehow you have been singled out and been treated unfairly simply because something didn't go your way. This is the life that always sees itself as a victim, that everyone is against me, that life isn't fair. This word speaks of the consistent grumbling of the heart that seems to have forgotten that it can rejoice evermore. 1 Thessalonians 5:16. And that it can give thanks in everything. 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 18. So I think it's important for us to make a distinction in that. I really don't believe it's wrong in the summer to say, well, I can't wait till it's the fall. I don't think we've committed sin and violated this passage in those kinds of statements about wishing something might be different. This goes deeper than that. This is something that is a problem of the heart in which one believes that he has a legitimate right to something that is really only given by grace, and then they get upset and gripe and complain about it because what they think is their right has been kept from them, when in reality it was no right at all. Now, why is this such a bad thing? Why should we not allow our lives to be that of playing the constant victim? Well, we get two reasons for that in Philippians chapter 2. in the first place, that kind of grumbling calls the sovereignty and wisdom of God into question. That type of grumbling calls the sovereignty and wisdom of God into question. Paul's emphasis in Philippians chapter 2 has been on humility and selflessness and the unity that those attitudes can foster. That's verses 1 through 4. Make my joy complete, verse 2, by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, being united in the same spirit, intent on one purpose, not doing anything through selfish ambition, but in lowliness of mind, esteeming the other better than yourself. That kind of humility fosters unity, and that is Paul's subject in the chapter. And then based on the example of the humility of Jesus, verses 5 through 11, he encourages them, verse 12, to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling because God is at work in them, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Notice that in verse 13. God is working out His will in their lives. As they submit to Him, as they try to grow in humility and seek unity, as they are working out their own salvation, God is also at work in their lives. God is fulfilling His will, His purposes in their lives. Now, it's interesting to me that on the heels of that statement, work out your own salvation because God's working in your life, that he says, now, do everything without grumbling. Which includes working out your own salvation. Do it without grumbling. Why? Because he's just told them God is working out his will in your life. And so if that's true, if God was at that moment working in them and through them for his good pleasure, then where is the good reason for grumbling about that? He's already told them earlier in the book, chapter 1, verse 6, he who began a good work in you will complete it unto the day of Christ. And God is working out his will in your life. As you're working out your own salvation, God's working his will in your life. So therefore, live your life without this constant grumbling and complaining. If God is working out his will in your life, what is there to complain about? To grumble, to live a life that is constantly playing the victim and constantly acting like you're being treated unfairly and that life just isn't fair for you. To do that in the face of the truth that God is working out His will in your life calls into question both God's right and His ability to govern His world and to govern your life. This was the problem with Israel in the wilderness. 1 Corinthians 10, back to the text that was read earlier. What was God doing? As the people had come out of Egypt and were on their way to the promised land, what was God doing? He was working out His will. He was accomplishing His purpose. Was it easy for them? No. Were there some hard days? Sure. But God was working out His will and His purpose in the lives of His people. And what did they do? They griped at every turn. They called into question God's will through Moses, God's spokesman. Why did you bring us out into this wilderness to die? We're better off back in Egypt. They felt like they had a right to whatever it was they wanted. And when they didn't get it, they felt justified in calling into question God's will that they had previously said they would follow. And so, underneath the complaints was an attitude that basically said, God doesn't know what He's doing in my life. It calls into question the sovereignty and the wisdom and the love of God. And I would argue that the same is true with us. I believe that you are where you are in life for some reason. Now, I don't know what that is specifically, because God doesn't reveal that to me. But God can work in and through us wherever we are right now. There are things that I can accomplish for the glory of God in my circumstances right now, whatever those circumstances may be. God can and will use you if you will let Him. And yet many times we find ourselves acting as if God has been unkind to us, that God has lined up against us, that God has done things to me that are not fair. Why do I have to go through this when so-and-so doesn't have to go through that? And we look at circumstances that are ours because of the sovereignty of God, and we act like we've been treated unfairly. That calls into question the wisdom of God, and it calls into question God's ruling His own world. And so instead of bemoaning those circumstances, let's bloom where we've been planted. Let's look for the opportunity to grow and mature and to help others in whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. And so the constant victim attitude calls into question God's will. Second reason why this kind of grumbling is bad is because it extinguishes your light. It extinguishes your light. Back to our text, Philippians 2. Again, look at verse 15. So that you'll prove yourself, this is when you do things without grumbling, you'll prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent, children of God above reproach, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Now, according to this text, that's what we are to be. Light. We are to shine as lights in the world. What kind of world are we lights in? Well, he tells us, a crooked and perverse one. Well, that was true for the Philippians. I'd argue it's not much different today. You see, as Christians, we're supposed to show the world a better way. I like this quote from G. Walter Hansen on this, commenting on this text. He said, this purpose clause, and he's talking about in the text, the purpose for which, or the reason why we're not to grumble and complain. Because, purpose, you shine as lights in the world. This purpose clause calls the Christian community to fulfill its mission in the world by cleaning up the conversation in the community. When Christian conversation is laced with complaints and personal attacks, Christians have lost their distinctive quality as the children of God in a world characterized by the same kind of negative tone. What's he saying? He's saying we're supposed to be different from the world around us. And if you look at the world around us, it probably doesn't take a whole lot of examination to realize that we live in a selfish, egocentric, whiny, self-pitying, self-absorbed world. That's the world in which we live. Now, we're supposed to offer the world something better. We're supposed to offer a better life. We're supposed to show people how to love life, how to be happy, how to be content, how to be joyous and positive in the same world that's turned them into cynics, scoffers, and pessimists. We live in the same world. If it's going to turn the people who are not of God into cynics and pessimists that are always whining and complaining, let it. We have got to rise above that and show them that there is joy in Christianity. There's joy in following Jesus. That you can live life in a world that is crooked and perverse, and yet you can live it with positivity. We can show people that, you know what? It doesn't make one bit of difference who's in the White House as it pertains to my happiness and satisfaction and joy in Christ. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, Philippians 4, verse 4. I like this quote too. It's hard to joyfully and consistently proclaim the gospel when all you do is complain about your mission field. Isn't the gospel good news? Really? Isn't that what the word means? Good news? Have you been affected by the good news? Is it good to you? Does it bring you joy? Knowing that you can live every day in the good graces of God, having been forgiven of your sins, to know that you are on a path to eternal life, does that bring you joy? Does it bring you happiness? Does it give you something to smile about? That's what we're supposed to project to the world. And yet many of us are no happier than the average person that's living every day burdened by their own sins. Some of us can be just as much sourpusses as those people are. And we do it to our shame. Complaining about this world is not going to change it. But shining a light of joy and contentment might. And that's what we've been called to do. So how about you and me? Are you a constant grumbler? Do you always play the victim? Have you allowed your outlook on life to be colored more by Fox News or CNN than the good news that Jesus died and rose again to give us hope that outshines the sun? Stop excusing that sin and start fulfilling your purpose to shine the light of joy and truth into a world that lacks both. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we come to you recognizing that far too many times we have been affected more by the negativity of our culture than the positivity of the good news of Jesus. And that's our fault. We pray that you would open our eyes to the blessings that we have in Jesus, to the abundant life that he's brought to us. And we pray, Father, that the joy that we feel and experience because of that will be seen in our actions, our words, and on our faces. We pray, Father, that we would not live like those who have no hope, but that we would allow our hope to bring smiles to our faces, gratitude to our hearts. And we pray that we would live each day expressing in word and in action how grateful we are that you have been so good to us. Help us, Father, to rejoice evermore, to pray without ceasing, and in everything to give thanks. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. I don't like to make assumptions, but I'm just going to make one tonight. And if I get in trouble for this, then I'll take my beating with a smile on my face and without a complaint. Here's my assumption. We could all do better in this regard. And it starts here. It starts with me. If you are like me and need a refresher, a reminder to not be dragged down by the pessimism of our world, then let's all pray for each other that we'll do that. And let's just make up our minds that we're going to do that. That's going to keep us from having all these front rows filled up here in a moment during the invitation song, because we don't have that many cards. So let's just all say we're going to pray for each other and try to do better, be grateful for our blessings. That said, if you do have a special request for prayer that you'd like to bring before the church, we do want to offer you that opportunity. If you're not a Christian and are ready to have your sins washed away by the blood of Christ, if you'll let us know that that's your need and your desire tonight, we'll help you to do that, to come to understand the Word of God and what your responsibility is in responding to the love of God in Jesus Christ. If we can help you in either of those ways, we invite you to come as we stand and sing. Somewhere I have some announcements. Here we go. These updates to announcements that were made on Sunday, the results from the surgery that Kevin Carroll's father, Neil, underwent, did reveal that his tumor is cancerous
He had had some melanoma in years past, and this is connected to that. He has been moved to Encompass Health and Rehabilitation in Bedford for rehab and for therapy. Don Payne had to go to the ER yesterday, but is now back at the lodge at Bear Creek and doing some better. Also, Don and Alma both had to get a new home phone number, and that's going to be printed in the bulletin this Sunday, so be aware of that. Robbie Mitchell, the father-in-law of Jim Wilcox's son, Rob, had to be taken back to the ER on Sunday, but Jim told me before services began tonight that he is now at home. And if you would like some assistance in signing up online for the COVID vaccine, if you would call or email the church office, then we will put you in touch with someone who can help you through that process. And there was something else that I was going to say that wasn't written down, and I can't remember what it was. So if I call all of you tonight at about 10:30 when it hits me, think nothing of it. All right? Do what?
Call them.
Yeah, a caller member is going to go off at 10:30 tonight because I remembered this announcement. No, thank you for being here tonight. Thank you to those of you joining us online. Let's stand and we'll have our closing song in prayer.
Pray together. O God, our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the privilege of coming before you again tonight to gather as your people and worship you. And Father, we thank you for the time we have been able to spend tonight in your word, to study your will for us. And Father, we know that we have been challenged and motivated to do better, to be more like Jesus, to be people who are fashioned in his image, who reflect his glory. And Father, we pray your blessings upon us as we go forth from here and strive to be your people, your servants, to do as you would have us to do. And Father, we pray that in all things, in what the words we say and the actions that we do, we pray, Father, that all would be done to your glory, that you would be lifted up and exalted. And we pray most of all, Father, that you would use us to bring your gospel and the good news of Jesus to the lost, that they may know your truth and be set free. Father, that their souls would be saved. And we pray, Father, that we would be courageous and diligent to teach your word, to speak where we need to speak. Father, to bring others to the hope that is in Christ. Father, we thank you so much for blessing us so richly, for being our God, for gathering us together as your people. And Father, we pray that you will continue to bless us and be with us as we take comfort in your presence. We ask you this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.